Flat Earth Proof 1, The Level. It is the natural physics of water to find and maintain a level surface. So then, all bodies of water should conform to the curvature of the Earth. That is, if the Earth is indeed a ball. Any body of water conforming to the curvature would therefore exhibit a distinctive bulge in its center. For instance, a lake 6 miles across would form a measurable mound of water in its center 6 feet high. Next time you're at a lake or at the ocean, keep an eye out for this obviously unobservable fact. Further confirming the non-curvature of the water's surface is the reflection of the moon in water. If the Earth were a ball and the moon in front of you, her reflection would be off the side of the curved water facing away from you, and therefore you wouldn't even see the lunar reflection. You would only see the moon's reflection if she were directly above or behind you, and it would appear as a spotlight on the water. Only on a flat plane does the reflecting light form in a straight line from horizon to observer. The surface of water is but one issue. Based on the claim that Earth is a spinning ball hurtling through space at such immense speeds, factoring in the many wobbles caused by asteroids, comets, and the like, such obviously consistently level surfaces should not even exist. So, leaving the water's surface aside, did you know that it is a fundamental fact that surveyors, engineers, and architects never factor in the supposed curvature of the Earth into their projects? Canals, railroads, tunnels, and bridges are all cut and laid horizontally, never allowing for any curvature, often over hundreds of kilometers. One surveyor of 30 years published in the Birmingham Weekly Mercury, "All our locomotives are designed to run on what may be regarded as true levels or flats. There are, of course, partial inclines or gradients here and there, but they are always accurately defined and must be carefully traversed. But anything approaching to 8 inches in the mile, increasing as the square of the distance, could not be worked by any engine that was ever yet constructed." He goes on to say, "Horizontal curves on levels are dangerous enough. Vertical curves would be 1,000 times worse, and with our rolling stock constructed as at present, physically impossible." As stated by the Manchester Ship Canal Company in Earth Review, "It is customary in railway and canal constructions for all levels to be referred to a datum which is nominally horizontal and is so shown on all sections. It is not the practice in laying out public works to make allowances for the curvature of the Earth." So investigate the subject for yourself and ask questions. Okay, here we are at Lake Minnewanka in Alberta, and as you can see, we're just less than a foot above the water surface here. And if we zoom in across the lake, the coastline across the lake clearly comes into focus. So you can see that the water clearly has no curvature, and the water surface is completely flat. So there you have it, folks. More conclusive proof. Here I am, not even a foot off the surface of the edge of the water. And we can zoom across here completely and see absolutely no curvature.
Flat Earth Proof 2, Pilot Principles. The Earth, said to spin eastward at a speed of 1600 kilometers per hour at the equator. So then, how is a plane able to fly eastward at half that speed and reach its destination in more or less the same time as the return flight, when in fact the plane should never reach its eastward destination before it comes rushing up from behind it? And how is it even remotely possible to safely land an aircraft on a runway moving at such a speed? I shouldn't have to mention that it would be disastrously impossible. We can discuss rotational speeds all day. While some claim that Earth's atmosphere is velcroed tightly to Earth's surface by gravity, despite no protection from the infinite vacuum supposedly surrounding it. But the one fact against the ball Earth model is that for the average commercial flight flying at 800 kilometers per hour, pilots would have to course correct at a descending rate of 850 meters per minute in order to follow the curvature of the Earth. Failure to do so would result in a 50,000 meter gain in altitude in just the first hour. In reality, once a plane reaches cruising altitude, all controls level out and are maintained level until descent for landing. Flat Earth Proof 3, Land Ho. In this episode, I will be presenting just some Flat Earth Proof 4, The Horizon. No matter where you go on our vast Earth, the horizon will always appear as a perfectly level line, 360 degrees all around you. This is true regardless of altitude. In fact, as you gain altitude, the horizon appears to maintain its height at eye level, despite the ground receding beneath you into the distance. If Earth were in fact a ball, then as you rose up, the horizon would appear to descend beneath you, appearing as a circle, getting smaller progressively as you rose up. But in reality, the horizon is always at eye level, no matter how high you go, which really only indicates one thing: an outstretched plane. The Earth is flat, and we've been had. Flat Earth Proof 5, Solar Rays. It's not uncommon to see sun's rays shining through the clouds at diverging angles, but after tracing these rays back to their source, it becomes apparent that the sun is not millions of miles away. Otherwise, all the rays would appear parallel. Rather, the sun is shown to be relatively close to the Earth, just above the clouds. Further demonstrating that the distance traveled by sunlight is not in the millions of miles is the fact that if the heat of the sun were indeed traversing the 93 million miles as claimed by modern science, then the stark difference in the sun's ability to heat the tropics versus the polar regions of this alleged relative speck shouldn't even exist, as the distance to the polar regions from the equator is just a mere 0.00004% further, or just 1/25,000th of the distance. Of course, Copernicus, Kepler, and Newton all came to various conclusions regarding the distance to the sun, not even coming near the 93 million miles as claimed by modern science. The real truth is that the number has astronomically increased, pun intended, as more and more precise instruments have failed to measure any stellar parallax. Flat Earth Proof 6, Polar Climates. If Earth were a globe, then it should follow that both the Arctic and Antarctic regions would share similar conditions and characteristics, such as comparative temperatures, seasons, length of daylight, etc. But in reality, the two regions are almost as different as night and day. To begin, let's address the prime influence on climate, the sun. While on a ball Earth, you'd expect the sun to behave very similar at both poles, in our investigation we find this is clearly not the case. For instance, the longest days in the north are much longer than those in the south. Dawn and dusk also occur differently in these two regions, with twilight coming and lasting much longer in the north, sometimes for over an hour,
compared to similar southern latitudes where twilight always comes and goes quickly, sometimes in a matter of minutes. This is exactly what is to be expected from a flat plain, with the sun circling above and around the central pole in 24-hour cycles, traveling steadily between the tropics every 6 months. Sticking to the sun, another contrasting point between the northern and southern regions is the midnight sun, a distinctly Arctic phenomenon occurring every year during the summer solstice, where, for several days, any observer significantly far north can watch the sun travel in circles overhead, not setting for upwards of 72 hours. Meanwhile, in Antarctica, corresponding with the Arctic midnight sun, the Royal Belgian Geographical Society notes that from May 17th to July 21st, the sun doesn't even rise above the Antarctic horizon. This is, of course, because during those days, the sun is at his innermost cycle, revolving tightly above and around the northern center. Though scientists will claim that the midnight sun is also an Antarctic experience, there are no uncut videos demonstrating this, nor are any independent explorers allowed into Antarctica to either verify or refute this claim. But that issues a whole other can of worms. Further demonstrating that the central northern regions receive a more benevolent climate than their southern counterparts would be the example of Iceland. At 65 degrees north latitude, Iceland thrives with 870 native plant species and abundant animal life. Compare this to Georgia Island, which, despite being a whole 11 degrees closer to the equator than Iceland, at 54 degrees south latitude, is nearly devoid of any ecoculture, having only a measly 18 native plant species and virtually no animal life. In fact, Captain James Cook lamented that he was unable to find there a single shrub large enough to make a toothpick. But to crown it all off, despite the Arctic regions enjoying moderately warm summers and manageable winters, where the average annual temperature is minus 15 degrees Celsius, Antarctica is by far the coldest place on Earth, with an average annual temperature of minus 50 degrees Celsius, where it never even warms enough to melt the perpetual ice and snow, and it also holds the all-time lowest temperature ever to be recorded on Earth of minus 93.2 degrees Celsius. Flat Earth Proof 7, Down South. All other proofs aside, the differences between the globe and the flat Earth become apparent when considering distances south of the equator. After all, haven't navigators, geographers, and mapmakers mapped these areas? And shouldn't they have noticed this quirk by now, if the Earth is indeed flat? Well, the reality is, the rabbit hole just gets deeper from here. So, to begin, the distance between Sydney, Australia and Nelson, New Zealand on the ball Earth, given their coordinates and sparing you the spherical trigonometry, should be 1,310 miles, but the Australian Handbook, Almanac, Shippers and Importers Directory states the measured distance as being 1,550 miles, which is a full 18% longer. And while on the ball Earth model, Antarctica is said to be a continent of ice situated at the bottom of the ball from 78 degrees south latitude, it should therefore not have a perimeter greater than 12,000 miles. However, early explorers like Captain Cook and James Clark Ross, in attempting to circumnavigate Antarctica, took 3 to 4 years to do so, and clocked in the distance traveled at 50 to 60,000 miles. That's twice the circumference of the equator. But the real proof for the flat Earth map is in the flight paths. On the ball Earth, several flights would have their shortest, quickest, and straightest path over or around the Antarctic continent.
But instead, these flights take all manner of tangential detours, crossing into the northern hemisphere to refuel. Their reason? Antarctica's too cold, they claim. Well, I'm not buying it. When they claim there are bases with working machinery set up all over Antarctica? So let's just take a look at the actual flight paths and see what they have to disclose. One flight that should be a simple 11-hour shot across the Indian Ocean is from Johannesburg, South Africa to Perth, Australia. However, this flight takes a detour north, stopping in either Dubai, Hong Kong, or Malaysia to refuel, for a total flight time averaging over 18 hours. This ridiculously wayward detour is frustrating to say the least, but on the flat Earth map starts to make sense. Another quick and easy flight, you would think, is from Johannesburg to Santiago, Chile. While an easy 12-hour flight below the Tropic of Capricorn is to be expected, instead, every flight crosses the equator to refuel in Senegal, all the way near the Tropic of Cancer, for a total flight time of 19 hours. Though it doesn't make sense on the globe, as you can see, it fits perfectly on the flat Earth map. A third flight from Johannesburg is to São Paulo, Brazil, which should be a direct 10-hour flight across the 25th degree south latitude. But instead, every flight crosses into the north to stop in London to refuel, making the total flight time 24 hours. From Santiago, Chile to Sydney, Australia, a straight 15-hour flight across the South Pacific is expected, despite refueling options in either New Zealand or any island in the South Pacific. The flight stops all the way at Los Angeles to refuel before continuing south to its destination. As already stated, these detours make no sense on the globe, but are explained and work perfectly well on the flat Earth map, having the North Pole at the center.
Flat Earth Proof 8, Star Trails. Consider the Earth as it is said to spin around its axis. At a speed of 1,000 miles per hour at the equator, whilst traveling 67,000 miles per hour in circles around the Sun, which is allegedly spiraling at 500,000 miles per hour around the Milky Way, with the galaxy itself rocketing through the universe at an appalling 670 million miles per hour, from an alleged cosmogenic explosion almost 14 billion years ago. Now consider that there are centuries-old sundials in the world, which still reliably tell time to the present day, some down to the precise minute. Further consider that the constellations and their countless descriptions in ancient inscriptions, texts, and star charts are exactly the same as in present day. If the Earth ball and all the stars were indeed shooting through the universe at the immense speeds described, then the stellar bodies should not even be as remotely as unchanging as they are. In fact, we should have a constantly changing night sky, with some stars moving obviously faster than others. Now, consider that the distance to Polaris is said to be 2 trillion miles. Here's a visual representation of that number. Now, try to comprehend this distance, and then ask yourself, with the wobble, rotation, and revolution of the Earth alone, how is it possible for such a distant object to stay so perfectly aligned in the same point of our sky for all our recorded history? Rather, Polaris should, in fact, have a trajectory of his own. Furthermore, on the ball Earth, Polaris shouldn't be visible from anywhere south of the equator,
as you'd have to be looking through the curvature of the Earth to do so. However, Polaris can be seen from as far south as 20 degrees south latitude and even further. In fact, there are so many constellations which can be seen much farther than expected, assuming the Ball Earth model. For instance, Ursa Major, right next to Polaris, can be seen from the North Pole all the way south to 30 degrees south latitude. Vulpecula can be seen from the North Pole to as far south as 55 degrees south latitude, whilst Taurus, Pisces, and Leo all can be seen from the North Pole to as far south as 65 degrees south latitude. Of course, none of this is possible assuming the Ball Earth model, but some even more extreme examples are Aquarius and Libra, which can be seen from 65 degrees north latitude to 90 degrees south latitude. Virgo is visible from 80 degrees north latitude to 80 degrees south latitude, and Orion can be seen from 85 degrees north latitude all the way to 75 degrees south latitude. These are all only possible because hemispheres are not actually parts of a sphere, but rather concentric rings around the central pole above which the stars rotate. So investigate the subject for yourself and ask questions.
Gee, I always thought they were balls of gas burning billions of miles away.
Pumbaa, with you, everything's gas.
Simba, what do you think?
Well, I don't know.
Oh, come on, well,
Come on, Simba.
We told you ours.
Somebody once told me that the great kings of the past are up there, watching over us.
Really?
You mean a bunch of royal dead guys are watching us?
Who told you something like that?
Yeah.
What mook made that up?
Yeah, pretty dumb, huh?
Oh, you're killing me, son.
Flat Earth Proof 9, The Authorities. The year is 1954, and Admiral Richard Byrd has just returned from his latest Antarctic expedition. Enthusiastically, he speaks of an unexplored land, quote, beyond the South Pole, as big as the United States. Calling it the future of the nation, he further touts it as being the most valuable and important place in the world for science, an untouched reservoir of untapped resources, including coal, oil, minerals, and uranium. Now, remember that these are the 1950s, and there are no environmental groups to argue sustainability. The world is the businessman's oyster, and the future is looking very promising. But here's where the twist comes in, because following Admiral Byrd's next mission to Antarctica, after supposedly returning to the United States, nothing happens. No further missions, no talk of any further exploration, nothing. And then a meeting was held between the nations eagerly awaiting to slice Antarctica up like apple pie, with all signatories agreeing to no colonization of Antarctica. In 1959, the Antarctic Treaty was enacted, barring any independent exploration of Antarctica by the public, with no revisions until the year 2041. Although independent explorers such as Jarl Andahoy have attempted independent access to Antarctica, as they've approached the southern latitude, they've been met by armed ships threatening to open fire on them if they didn't turn around and go back. There are only three entry points to Antarctica sanctioned by the Antarctic Treaty, through which civilians may enter and tour Antarctica, but only under the supervision of pre-planned tours. To date, over 50 nations have signed on to the Antarctic Treaty, which, to this day, remains unbreached. Now, has any other treaty between industrialized nations lasted so long?
Furthermore, as rocket science was also a quickly expanding field at the time, it only followed that the authorities seized control over the aeronautic industry before private enterprises were able to venture high enough and disclose the globe deception. With the establishment of NASA, the space program was militarized, and all the best and brightest scientists and engineers were then recruited and compartmentalized by this government agency. The lunar missions were aptly named after Apollo, as their prime purpose was to reinforce the heliocentric paradigm in that both the Earth and the Moon are orbs orbiting the Sun. In reality, the rocket launches are merely a spectacle, with all launches curving off and falling back to Earth out of view, and the images they've fed us faked, composited, or downright computer-generated. But the authorities have in fact known what the real map looks like, and they've managed to keep most navigators, astronomers, and the populace unaware behind the globe and celestial sphere, not to mention Mercator's projection. But the United States Geological Survey, or USGS for short, the prime atlas and map makers of the world, have been using a completely different map, the azimuthal equidistant projection, which was developed and proposed 1,000 years ago by Abu Rayhan Biruni, a Persian scholar who believed the Earth was flat. But hey, the authorities that shouldn't be love hiding their secrets in plain sight. Flat Earth Proof 10, The Legends. It goes without having to say that every culture has described the Earth as being flat and motionless. Ancient sailors and astronomers throughout the ages hadn't noticed any hints alluding to a globe. But despite their efforts, the knowledge they had collected systemically over the ages was eventually neglected and then largely forgotten. Though we will cover the how, let's first have a look through some of these ancient descriptions and see how they tend to describe the world we live on. The ancient Egyptians perceived the Earth to be a flat plain, personified in the Netcher Geb. Arching over the Earth was Nut, the personification of the sky, who every morning gave birth to Ra, the sun. Beyond this was the realm called Duat, the place where deceased souls would go and await rebirth, while beyond the universe was the infinite expanse of the waters of Nu. The Vedic spiritualists described a spherical universe, one out of an infinite number, with the earth plane in the center dividing the heavenly half from subterranean worlds. The earth plane itself is a series of concentric rings of alternating ocean and land, with the central island the abode of humanity. At the very center of this universe is the cosmic axial mountain, Mount Sumeru, atop of which are cities of the gods. Compare this to Mount Olympus in the Greek legends. Further in Vedic cosmology, the sun, moon, and planets all have their orbits in layers above the flat plane revolving around the central pole star, above which is the abode of the Creator. Another ancient worldview is that of the ancient Scandinavians, who, according to the sagas, saw humans as inhabiting Midgard, the most central of many worlds. Surrounding Midgard is a great ocean which itself is encircled by the cosmic serpent Jormungandr. In the center of Midgard stands Yggdrasil, the cosmic tree whose branches connect the world of Midgard to other worlds of fire, ice, giants, and elves, with its roots reaching into the netherworlds, and its upper branches reaching high into the heavenly worlds and Asgard, where Valhalla is, while Sol the sun and Mani the moon forever chase each other over and around Midgard. One detailed description of the chase between sun and moon is exemplified in the fable of the tortoise and the hare, in which the hare, who represents the sun, starts the race out arrogant and speedily, overtaking the tortoise as the sun does the moon during the northern summer months. then slowing down in the winter when the steady-paced moon once again overtakes the sun in orbit. The paths of the sun and moon above the flat disk Earth, as well as lunar phases, were encoded in the Chinese yin-yang symbol. The ancient Mesopotamians also believed in a flat disk Earth, which the surviving Babylonian account describes as having been formed from half the slain body of Tiamat, the primordial chaos, with the other half of her body being stretched out to form the skies and the netherworld, where all souls went to await after death. Situated above the pole star was the throne of the gods, and whilst the entire earth was surrounded by a salt ocean, a ridge of high mountains encircling the edge kept the waters from overflowing. Following Abraham out of Mesopotamia, all Abrahamic religions follow in describing the world as being fashioned in 6 days of evening and morning, and being fixed and immovable. The Hebrew cosmology describes the sun and moon as being set in the sky, and beneath the earth was the realm of Sheol, where deceased souls await in silence. Here are just some selections in regard to the nature of the cosmos, translated directly from the Hebrew texts. He encircles a boundary upon the face of the waters, unto the end of light and darkness. Who founded the earth upon her foundations, she shall not totter forever and ever. It is he who sits upon the circle of the earth, who stretches out the skies like a curtain, and spreads it out like a tent to dwell in. Is not God in the height of the heaven? And see the head of stars, how high is he? In addition, the first creation account of Genesis describes Elohim as fashioning the firmament, the Hebrew word rakira, implying the hammering of metal into a sheet, denoting a solid sky shield. Further accounts in the Hebrew canon describe the sun as stopping in the sky for about the length of a day, and even retrograding by 10 degrees on a sundial. The Arabic revelation describes a similar cosmology. And he has cast in the earth firm mountains, lest it shake with you, and rivers and roads, so that you may be guided. Have we not made the earth a resting place, and the mountains as pegs? Who created 7 heavens in layers, you don't see in the creation of the Most Merciful any fault. So return your vision. Can you see any flaw? Then return your vision a second time. Your vision will return to you humbled when fatigued. And it is he who created the night and the day, and the sun and the moon, all in orbit, are swimming. I was only able to cover a handful of these ancient world descriptions in this episode, but it must be noted that nearly all of these beliefs, with the exceptions of those absorbed and bastardized by the Church of Rome, have been hunted down and suppressed worldwide, with the surviving of these descriptions written off by their own institutions as either figurative or ancient ignorance. While the colonialists and missionaries of the European empires were of course all formally dispatched by their respective monarchs, they were all under the thumb of the brotherhoods operating from beneath the Vatican. In reality, there is only this one empire in the world today. Of course, they began by clearing out the Library of Egypt and burning down the building. In Scandinavia, natives who didn't renounce their beliefs in exchange for the cross of Christianity were shackled to rocks in bays and left to drown as the tides slowly ebbed in. Once the British established their standards in India, holy men, Ayurvedic doctors, and even just ordinary people who refused to wage work were rounded up and put in the very first insane asylums. The Chinese were so well versed in the knowledge of the earth and spirituality that it took the Jesuit spies years of scheming in order to devise plans that would ultimately displace traditional Chinese philosophy with Western science and ultimately communism, not to mention having pushed opium on the people for decades. Now, the first person credited as describing the ball earth in orbit around the sun was Pythagoras of Samos, to whose school Freemasonry traces their origins, and whose idea wasn't even able to convince the populace until it curiously resurfaced 2,000 years later, shortly after the supposed discovery of the New World, when the Vatican vehemently began to displace original cultures worldwide. Flat Earth Proof 11. Outer Space. The Earth. Wait for it. Wait for it. It's supposedly here. An insignificantly tiny speck, they say. Somewhere in this vast vacuum. Ah, yes. The infinite vacuum of space. Said to be in direct contact with the atmosphere of Earth. Yes? But the atmosphere is, of course, gas and should expand indefinitely to fill its container. But since the container of Earth's atmosphere is the entire area of space, then it should follow the second law of thermodynamics and establish equilibrium, as is the case in every single experiment ever conducted. In other words, after the alleged 4.5 billion years of Earth speeding around the Sun at over 100,000 kilometers per hour, the atmosphere should have long since dissipated by now. But there's gravity, people argue, maintaining the atmosphere perfectly. Right, whilst of course allowing simultaneous cross-directional winds to blow, insects to hover, birds to take off and fly, smoke to rise, not to mention helium-filled balloons, etc., etc., notwithstanding that it has never been shown that any object will attract matter to it due to its mass alone. So, let's just turn to investigate the vehicles of space and ask, can rockets work in a vacuum? A logically necessary question. Well, to answer, rockets require matter to push against in order to move forward. And according to repeatable experiments, rockets simply spin violently out of control when placed to function in a vacuum. Now, consider during Apollo 17 how the astronauts were able to capture the blue marble image at only a tenth of the distance to the moon. This is akin to taking a picture of the runway from an airplane shortly after takeoff. This fact alone raises suspicions, but becomes even more apparent when one realizes that NASA only releases rear-facing footage from their rockets, and never forward-facing footage. But NASA admitting to the threat of drowning in space is the loudest testimony against their charade, with bubbles being caught rising on spacewalk footage supposedly being carried out in the vacuum of space. Really? What substance is lighter than a vacuum so that it can rise in it? Flat Earth Proof 12. Lunar Enigma. Have you noticed the cooling effect of moonlight? No, really, because moonlight is demonstrably cooling, not heating. As opposed to the golden preserving effects of sunlight, moonlight is instead curiously silver and putrefying. Not only is the temperature of moonlight not what we've been led to presume, but during the waxing and waning phases of the moon, it is even possible to occasionally see stars and planets directly through the disk of the moon. Some documented examples of this phenomenon include 4 astronomers writing in the Philosophical Transactions of the Royal Astronomical Society on March 7, 1794, that they, quote, saw a star in the dark part of the moon, which had not then attained the first quadrature, and from the representations which are given, the star must have appeared very far advanced upon the disk, end quote. On April 7, 1848, Sir James South of the Royal Observatory in Kensington wrote in a letter to the Times newspaper stating that, quote, on the 15th of March, 1848, when the moon was 7.5 days old, I never saw her unilluminated disk so beautifully. On my first looking into the telescope, a star of about the 7th magnitude was some minutes of a degree distant from the moon's dark limb. I saw that its occultation by the moon was inevitable. He goes on to say, the star, instead of disappearing the moment the moon's edge came in contact with it, apparently glided on the moon's dark face, as if it had been seen through a transparent moon, or as if a star were between me and the moon. I have seen a similar apparent projection several times. The cause of this phenomenon is involved in impenetrable mystery. As further noted in the monthly notices of the Royal Astronomical Society for June 8, 1860, Thomas Gaunt stated of the occultation of Jupiter by the moon on the 24th of May, 1860, quote, I could not see the dark limb of the moon until the planet appeared to touch it, and then only to the extent of the diameter of the planet. But what I was most struck with was the appearance on the moon as it passed over the planet. It appeared as though the planet was a dark object and glided on to the moon instead of behind it, and the appearance continued until the planet was hid, when I suddenly lost the dark limb of the moon altogether." End quote. In fact, seeing stars through the moon is actually a phenomenon occurring fairly often, and if you are diligent and specifically looking for this phenomenon on a starry night, you can occasionally see it, even with the naked eye. Flat Earth Proof 13, the International Space Station. The International Space Station, at an orbital height of over 300 kilometers in the thermosphere. Wait, the thermosphere? You mean where it is said to reach extreme temperatures due to the absorption of highly energized solar radiation? Because the International Space Station is comprised mostly of aluminum, the melting point of which is a mere 660 degrees Celsius, compared to the 2000 degrees Celsius said to exist in the thermosphere. NASA only digs their grave deeper when they then claim that the air molecules in the thermosphere are so sparse that the temperature can't even transfer to a thermometer, going so far as to say it actually feels cold in the thermosphere. Okay. Don't ask me how they were able to then measure the 2000 degrees Celsius in the first place. But then you ask me, how is the International Space Station electrically grounded? And you've stumped me. So we ask NASA, and their response is that the ISS is grounded by the very air surrounding it. Wait. You mean to tell me that air that's so sparse it won't even register the intense temperature of 2000 degrees Celsius onto a thermometer is able to maintain the electrical grounding of the entire space station? Since when does air ever discharge static? But before we get sucked down into absurdity, let's consider the velocity of Earth through space, and then take into consideration the innumerable amounts of not only meteors, but micrometeors, interstellar space dust, and floating debris all traveling at comparable speeds, which should all pose a very real and constant threat, not only to the International Space Station, but to all the astronauts said to be on board. In fact, the sheer infinitude of undetectable micrometeors shooting through space from whichever haphazard impact like bullets should make every spacewalk a real life-threatening assignment. But every astronaut is always laughing about how much fun their jobs all are, whilst constantly inserting lame attempts to identify with viewers. They even go so far as to hairspray their female astronauts' hair, making it look like anything but authentic weightlessness. The scenes where they are on harnesses are equally as laughable, as well as when turbulence is encountered on their outfitted zero-g planes. Not to mention bubbles being caught on film during their spacewalks. Though there is a trackable image resembling the International Space Station as it is said to move across the sky, the image is strangely prismatic, resembling a hologram, and does not in fact look like an actual orbiting piece of machinery. Clearly, for the reasons already stated, the International Space Station cannot exist the way NASA claims. Flat Earth Proof 14, Satellites. Have you ever seen a satellite? Though some people claim that the moving lights they see in the night sky are satellites, consider that at a minimum height of 160 kilometers, large satellites are said to be about the size of a city bus. Now, can you see a bus at even 20 kilometers away? Not to mention that the thermosphere is also said to exist at this distance, where the 660 degrees Celsius melting point of the aluminum comprising the satellites would be far exceeded by the 2,000 degrees Celsius of the thermosphere. Even the 1,660 degrees Celsius melting point of some of the titanium components would be exceeded by over 300 degrees. Now, I must emphatically state here that no one has ever seen a satellite. They do not exist, and every image of one that has been presented to you has been that of a computer-generated cartoon. The Hubble Space Telescope is another deception that flat out doesn't exist either, with every image from there a work of Photoshop. The deception is further exposed in the fact that geosynchronistic satellites, which are satellites orbiting with the rotation of the Earth, are said to be in precise synchronization in orbit around the Earth, and that any deviation, even by so much as a fraction of an inch, would result in a lost signal. Though NASA says earthquakes are among the things that slow the rotation of the Earth, these alleged satellites are yet able to maintain perfect geosynchronicity, with the occurrence of mishaps few and far between. Not to mention NASA relatively ignoring the threats posed from the infinite numbers of micrometeors and space rocks shooting unpredictably like bullets through the expanses of space. Flat Earth Proof 15. Sunrise, sunset. Whenever a light shines through a dense medium, it will appear larger to the observer due to the increased glare. This effect is further intensified when the air through which the light is shining is dense with moisture. Since the densest air is right above the Earth's surface, it goes to say that as the sun moves away from the observer, its rays would have to pass through more dense air than it would when it is directly overhead. Therefore, at sunrise and sunset, the light appears dilated with its color modified. While the laws of perspective also cause the sun and moon to appear smaller as they move away from the observer, the final result between these two opposing effects is what we see. And from many dry, high-altitude locations, it is possible to see the sun and moon appear to vanish into a point before disappearing beyond the horizon. Further evidence demonstrating that the sun is a localized spotlight moving overhead rather than the Earth orbiting around it at 93 million miles are what appear to be focused hotspots seen directly on clouds below the sun as viewed from airplanes. This is further exemplified by sighting in the tropics of the large sun phenomenon. Flat Earth Proof 16. Magnetic North. On the ball Earth, a compass needle is forever torn between having to simultaneously point to two constantly moving geomagnetic poles, and if it were actually drawn downward towards the north pole of the ball, the southern end of the compass needle would be pointing upwards, off into space. Not to mention that the entire core theory of the ball Earth model is pure speculation and conjecture based on what I call earthquake echoes, when in reality the deepest exploration ever was the Russian Kola Ultra Deep project, which only managed 12 kilometers before their drill bits started to seize up and quit. In fact, ball magnets, like they claim the ball Earth is, don't exist anywhere in nature, much less a magnetic ball of molten metal. But ring magnets do exist, having their north pole in the center and the south polarity along their outer rim, which perfectly exemplifies the magnetism of the flat Earth. Now, ancient accounts describe the cause of the magnetic North Pole as originating from a cosmic mountain situated in the center of the Earth plane, which is also the center of the universe, where four rivers feed into the mountain, changing their directions every 6 hours, causing the tides on Earth. The mountain was also said to possess a magnetic force so strong that it was alleged to be able to pull the nails clean from ships. Flat Earth Proof 17. Eclipses. Doesn't it strike you, when observing the sun and moon coursing through the sky, that both appear as similar-sized orbs, tracing similarly related 24-hour paths overhead at similar speeds? Is this simply just coincidence? Well, modern astronomy would say, absolutely, no question about it. Despite the sun and moon appearing to be the same size, the sun is in fact 400 times larger and 400 times farther away. The sun is in fact the orbital center, with the very Earth we're standing on spinning around it. Now, during a solar eclipse, it is claimed that the moon is passing between the observer and the sun, thus blocking the light of the sun temporarily from the view of the observer. Okay, then what about lunar eclipses? Well, according to the authorities, as we've all been fed, lunar eclipses occur when the ball Earth moves between the sun and the moon, and we see the resulting shadow. But over 50 times in the last 500 years, none other than the Royal Astronomical Society of Britain has noted lunar eclipses which occurred when both the sun and moon were visible in the sky. Not to mention several of those times when the alleged ball Earth shadow has been seen on the wrong side of the lunar disk. Further, how is it possible that during a total lunar eclipse, the shadow starts off completely black as it creeps up on the moon, but when it fully covers the moon exhibits that signature reddish glow? My own research has led me to see that the authorities know about and are hiding information regarding a black sun, referred to in Vedic cosmology by the names Rahu and Ketu, classically described as orbs which eclipse both the sun and the moon in regular 18-year cycles. Flat Earth Proof 18. Gravity or density? On the ball Earth, there's no real up or down. It's all relative to the center, and this is possible thanks to gravity. Now, naturally, a spinning object tends to keep other objects from sticking to it due to centrifugal force, normally causing the objects to fly right off. But on the ball Earth, thanks to gravity, of course, people, buildings, and even the very air are all stuck to the surface of the ball, and would be none the wiser had it not been for authorities such as Galileo, Newton, and NASA to tell us otherwise. Thusly, considering gravity, if objects with mass are attracted towards each other, why hasn't there ever been an object massive enough to demonstrate that water would stick to it, as is claimed the oceans, lakes, and rivers do on a ball Earth? And if the excuse is then given that the Earth's gravity would far supersede that of any other object, then how is it that the moon is said to affect water levels at sea level on Earth? Further, how is the combined mass of a helium-filled balloon repelled by the mass of the Earth? Or what up there is attracting the balloon to itself? Or are these really just the laws of density and buoyancy, with up and down actually existing as we perceive? Obviously, dense objects sink when placed in a less dense medium, and this law of density buoyancy perfectly explained the physics of falling objects long before Isaac Newton proposed his theory of gravity. But Isaac Newton was a knight of the British Order, and I personally find it strange that he was allegedly born on Christmas Day and died on the vernal equinox. And why did his coat of arms have two crossed bones on a black shield? Was he indeed a Freemason or a Rosicrucian? I also question Galileo and his supposed experiments, dropping his balls from the Leaning Tower of Pisa, while Giordano Bruno and other contemporaries of Galileo were burned at the stake after being publicly tortured. Galileo was merely placed under supposed house arrest, while his associations with the Jesuits have long been acknowledged. Flat Earth Proof 19, Revisiting the Level. If the Earth were indeed a ball, then the horizon would always appear to curve significantly around you, even at sea level. It can easily be shown, however, to be otherwise by holding a level or even a straight edge against the horizon line of any ocean or large enough lake. Furthermore, distant objects such as buildings, mountains, and hot air balloons would all appear to gradually lean backwards away from you the farther away they were, following the curvature of the ball Earth. In fact, as a hot air balloon progresses farther away, it should lean over so that you begin to see the bottom of its basket while the top of the balloon tips away from you. While one favorite alleged proof for the ball Earth is the claim that a ship's hull will disappear from view first as it travels out on the ocean, this claim actually proves otherwise when, with a simple telescope, one can zoom in onto the ship and bring the hull back into view. This is because of the laws of perspective and how a vanishing point works, not due to the ball Earth's curvature. Additionally, water always exhibits a flat surface, no matter how large the body of water, with the Bedford Level experiment probably the most well-known experiment, which itself can in fact be repeated on any lake or canal, really. In this experiment, a boat carrying a flag 5 feet above the water sailed the 6-mile stretch across the canal. At the other end, a telescope 8 inches above the water was able to maintain sight of the flag despite supposed to have been hidden behind an arc of water 6 feet high on the ball Earth. Another similar experiment was conducted in which 5-foot flags were placed at 1-mile intervals along a shoreline. When viewed from one end through a scope, all flags lined up in a straight line, as expected on a flat plane Earth. Flat Earth Proof 20, More Experiments. While there are many experiments one can easily do to simply verify that the flat, motionless plane we live on is not round or spinning, here are some experiments which are a bit more decisive, challenging current scientific models. To begin, the Michelson-Morley experiments, in which a beam of light was split and then sent in two directions, one along the alleged rotation of the Earth and one perpendicular to it, and then onto a film, on which any interference would be recorded, measuring the difference in speed traveled by the two beams. However, no interference was detected. The Sagnac experiment also split a beam of light, but measured its interference whilst traveling opposite directions along the edges of a rotating turntable. Instead of noting an oscillating interference pattern, as expected on a rotating Earth, one beam was found to be traveling consistently longer than the other, denoting a stationary Earth. This critical discovery had to be concealed by the scientific establishment, so the Fitzgerald-Lorentz contraction was concocted, claiming with no justification that the beam of light traveling in the direction of Earth's rotation became shorter and therefore the light traveled less distance. There was no basis for such an explanation other than the desperate attempt to excuse away these critical findings. In addition to the previously mentioned experiments, Airy's failure, in which George Airy failed to have to adjust his telescope due to his presumption of a moving Earth. While, relatively, there's no way to tell whether the Earth or stars are actually moving, by filling a telescope with water, the starlight entering the telescope is slowed greatly, and in order to still view the starlight on a rotating ball Earth, an adjustment to the angle of the telescope would be necessary. But if the stars are rotating, no adjustment is necessary. Though George Airy expected a necessary adjustment of 30 seconds of an arc, he failed to mark even so much as a single second's adjustment, proving that the telescope and thus the Earth was stationary. Further exhibiting a stationary Earth is the Red Bull Stratosphere Dive, in which Felix Baumgartner, after ascending over New Mexico for over 3 hours, should have landed over 3,000 kilometers west into the Pacific Ocean. But Felix landed 70 kilometers east from his takeoff point, literally flying in the face of the ball Earth allegedly rotating at over 1,000 kilometers per hour at that latitude. It also serves to point out that vertically fired cannonballs should all fall significantly west, but they always fall back down no more than 2 feet from the cannon, many times falling directly back into the muzzle. Further, on a spinning ball Earth, north and south facing cannons would have to establish a control, while eastwardly fired cannonballs would travel significantly farther, with west firing cannons covering the shortest distances. But regardless of direction and what some people claim, bullets and cannonballs always cover the same distances and never curve due to the so-called Coriolis effect. Flat Earth Proof 21. The Tides. How is it possible that the moon's gravity is said to cause the tides when, at sea level, the gravitational force of the Earth is said to far surpass that of the moon? While the tides do seem to follow the moon's motions overhead, upon closer inspection, one will realize that the motions of the moon overhead are regular, while the tides, not so much so around the world. Indeed, if it truly were the lunar mass attracting Earth's waters towards it, then all lakes, ponds, and other standing bodies of water would similarly experience the swelling and ebbing of the tides. Heck, even rivers and canals would exhibit some sign of being under lunar influence, yet these all remain mysteriously out of the moon's gravitational grip. And if the gravity of the moon were truly tugging on the waters of the Earth, there would be nothing to stop the water, particularly while in vapor suspension, to continue on upwards under the lunar influence and find its way onto the moon. Flat Earth Proof 22. The Coriolis Effect. It is claimed, due to Earth's rotation, that water draining in sinks and toilets in the northern hemisphere spins clockwise, whilst upside down in the southern hemisphere, it spins counterclockwise. There are also claims that snipers and ballistic calculations have to establish a control, when this is clearly not the case. Just as with Foucault's pendulum, while they blatantly claim it rotates with Earth's alleged spin, in reality spins in either direction without discrimination, neither do sinks nor toilets drain consistently as claimed by the so-called Coriolis effect, with many sinks having been found to drain both ways, simply depending on the shape of the basin and the angle of the water's entry, not from the alleged rotation of the Earth. Hurricanes and other cyclonic storms also do not follow the alleged Coriolis effect, with global wind patterns appearing to blow haphazardly around the ball. But when looking at the wind patterns on the azimuthal equidistant map projection, the weather patterns are found to consistently spin counterclockwise around the flat Earth, paralleling the rotation of the Sun, Moon, and planets against the stellar mobile above. The only ready explanation for this link between these two seemingly unrelated phenomena is in the ancient philosophical concept that the universe is manifest within an ocean of ether, and everything is interconnected.
Flat Earth Proof 23. Daytime Moon. On a ball Earth, the full moon should never be visible in the sky at the same time as the sun, as you'd have to be looking through the Earth in order to do so. No matter how high your altitude, the horizon never descends below eye level, as you'd expect on a ball. In this shot, we can clearly see the full moon well above the horizon, despite the risen sun already climbing in the eastern sky behind the camera. And if light were actually bending around these bodies, as some claim, then shouldn't it follow that all these lights appear blurry to us, their edges undefinable as their shed light scatters and bends madly off in all directions? But the luminaries always appear clearly outlined, as they are, unless obfuscated by clouds. So then, how is this phenomenon possible on a ball Earth? The answer is that it's simply not, and the Earth is flat, with basic laws of perspective determining the angles at which we observe sun and moon. Flat Earth Proof 24, The Gyroscope. The gyroscope. This basically simple, yet ingenious device proves the flat Earth. How so? Well, observe this mechanism once set into motion. At once, it resists any attempt to change its set orientation, maintaining its original spin axis, regardless of whether one changes the orientation of its outer frame. It is precisely this feature which allows it to be used in gyrocompasses, serving to maintain directional bearings in ships, aircrafts, and other vehicles. Yet, on a spinning ball Earth, the orientation of the gyroscope would shift a whole 15 degrees per hour, simply to account for the rotation of the Earth beneath it. Still not convinced? Well, what about the obvious drift around its third axis in an airplane, as it courses around the 3D ball Earth? In reality, whenever any attempts are made at measuring any detectable shift in bearing, they fail, as any well-calibrated gyroscope will always faithfully point forever in the same direction. Just as in the example of Foucault's pendulum, said to demonstrate the Coriolis effect, these are just verbal anecdotes weakly attempting to enforce the globe model by being repeated so often matter-of-factly by people who have never observed any data to support their claims, whilst all observable experiments consistently demonstrate otherwise. Flat Earth Proof 25. Rainbows. According to the current curriculum, rainbows are formed when sunlight is split into its component colors when it refracts through water droplets suspended in the air. But when pressed to duplicate this phenomenon using an artificial source of light, experiments always fall short, instead relying on a prism to split a beam of light, failing to have it manifest in 3D airspace as true rainbows do, yet still saying, "Ah, there you go, see, a rainbow." But rainbows are not merely prismatic projections, as they distinctively form in the shape of an arc, as well as moving relative to the position of the observer. Two peculiar features of true rainbows which these experiments fail to even consider. But have you ever wondered why rainbows are oft visible outdoors, yet nearly never indoors? Sure, it's easy to refract light using a prism and cast its split colors onto an opaque surface, but a true rainbow cannot be demonstrated without relying on the sun itself, or, in some more obscure instances, using a secondary light source or a mirror. Now, if it were simply water droplets refracting the light as a prism does, it would then cast the separated colors onto a surface from which you could view it. This projection, like that from a prism, would not move relative to the observer. Not to mention that instead of forming a well-defined arc like that of a true rainbow or even multiple bows, it would rather project the separated light onto all droplets in the air, a prism from every droplet reflecting off of every droplet, creating a surreal sheen of iridescent mist. But the full shape of a true rainbow becomes apparent when the observer's altitude is sufficient to reveal the entire halo-shaped projection. Considering this, as well as the need for a reflection of the primary light source in true rainbow reproductions, could it then be inferred that the sun's light may be reflecting off something round, thus creating the shape and projection of a rainbow? Understanding this projection is quite likely the beginning in understanding the nature of our sky, or firmament, as some refer to it as. It could very well be that this is the structure which is reflecting sunlight, thus providing the secondary light source necessary to project a true rainbow, and why it is only possible to see a rainbow when the sun is behind you. Flat Earth Proof 26, The Analemma. This is the analemma, the path the sun traces in the sky above the earth over the course of the year. You may have been introduced to this graph in school, but it was probably not much more than a brief honorable mention, associating it with old school navigation in an era long past. Whilst old maps consistently incorporated this element, usually with great detail, newer maps curiously seem to leave this component out altogether. Now, imagine if maps began leaving out the compass rows, or latitudinal and longitudinal lines of reference. And this analemma charts the very path of the sun overhead. Maybe there's a clue here that could lead us in the right direction. Shouldn't a ball Earth, undoubtedly having symmetrical northern and southern hemispheres, have the sun form a symmetrical figure eight overhead? So what's the deal with the crossing point being so northerly off-center? Well, authorities claim this variation is due to the fluctuation in speed of the Earth, as it is said to increase as it nears the sun in January and decreases when it's farthest from the sun in June, thus keeping to Kepler's principle of equal area and angular momentum. But looking at the actual alleged orbit of the Earth, which forms a near perfect circle, supposedly, it simply doesn't match the analemma's variation, despite the analemma being in fact how the sun observably travels back and forth between the tropics in its yearly circuit over and around the flat Earth. In fact, so stark is this discrepancy that some modern textbooks have even gone so far as to revise the shape of the analemma into a perfect figure eight, which any navigator would have considered misinformation, an oversimplification of the actual graph. But the analemma, curiously, is not the only thing they've removed from their public curriculum over time. Flat Earth Proof 27, Circumnavigation. The Earth isn't flat. Don't you know anything? Haven't you heard of circumnavigation? Well, yes, but every circumnavigator has traveled in an eastward or westward direction. Find one that has broken the north-south barrier, and then we can talk. Because just as the sun traveled east to west every day, those circumnavigators are simply making this kind of circle around the flat plane. But nobody will ever be able to go south, past the Antarctic ice wall, continuing on past the alleged South Pole, to come up under the other side of Antarctica and back up northwardly bound, because that's simply not the kind of world we live on. And if it indeed were, they would have surely long since had someone accomplish this feat by now. But obviously, they can't. Flat Earth Proof 28, The Clouds. Have a look around on any semi-cloudy day. and take notice of the clouds further away, near the horizon. Notice particularly the bottoms of the clouds, how they all seem to form a straight line, level in the distance, parallel to the horizon, all the way around you. Not only do the clouds not appear to curve from side to side, increasingly so the higher you go, with a fisheye horizon being the norm, but on a ball, the clouds would additionally lean over, falling over the horizon, which is allegedly where the curvature of the supposed globe is said to begin, thus allowing you to see their flat bottoms meeting the line of the ground. Of course, it's not that way, with deniers resorting to such justifications as, "The Earth is just too big to notice any curvature, derp." So, if the clouds don't curve, when the sun is setting, supposedly at 90 degrees to the observer on a ball, the clouds should demonstrably be illuminated from their underside, their dark portions on their tops. But instead, clouds will only appear illuminated from above or from their sides, whilst twilight fades out around the setting point of the sun, and not evenly across the western sky, as would be expected on a ball. Flat Earth Proof 29. Time Zones. Time zones are said to be caused by the rotation of the ball Earth, so that when one side of the ball faces the sun, that side is experiencing day, whilst the opposite side experiences night. On the Flat Earth model, however, the sun is much closer to the Earth than claimed by modern science, acting more like a local spotlight overhead as it revolves around the central pole in 24-hour cycles, illuminating the areas beneath it, then disappearing beyond the scope of the observer's perspective as it moves farther away, creating the illusion of sunrise and sunset. An interesting side note, further demonstrating that this phenomenon occurs on a flat plane as opposed to a ball, is that on a ball, 12 o'clock noon in the summer would wind up shifting, becoming 12 o'clock midnight in the winter, and vice versa. Additionally, at northern latitudes, the Arctic phenomenon known as the midnight sun frequently illuminates parts of the Earth on opposite sides of the North Pole simultaneously for periods lasting up to several days. But in Antarctica, the sun has never been shown to illuminate lands on opposite sides of the alleged geographical South Pole simultaneously, whilst unedited videos featuring the Antarctic midnight sun remain elusive even now. So investigate the subject for yourself and ask questions.